Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Review Night on Union Station by E.M. Foner. Narrated by Hollie Jackson. 1. In conclusion, it is the view of Union Station Embassy that the upcoming review of humanity's progress towards integration with the tunnel network will be a valuable opportunity to solicit guidance from the older species, especially those which generally hold themselves aloof from dealing with us outside of diplomatic contacts, and I fully expect a positive report. Kelly inhaled and shook her head ruefully at her unintentional edit. She had planned to say something encouraging about how all of the alien businesses setting up shop on Earth in recent years were creating a small but effective pro-human lobby in some quarters. Unfortunately, it had slipped her mind after she began speaking, and she doubted her ability to include it in a new conclusion without forgetting something else. The purpose of our soliciting guidance from existing Tunnel Network members is to give them a chance to influence the decision process regarding your probationary status, Libby informed the ambassador. Kelly reflexively glanced up at the ceiling before replying to the omnipresent Strix librarian. I thought this whole review was just a formality, though to tell you the truth, I'm still a little fuzzy on what we would gain by getting off of probationary status and becoming full members. Jeeves already told me that Earth will remain a protectorate until we develop a self-defense capability. The primary benefit is access to certain information that is currently being withheld due to your probationary status. Such as? I'm afraid that answer would fall within the domain of certain information that is currently being withheld due to your probationary status, Libby replied innocently. Sounds like a pig in a poke to me, Kelly grumbled. Do you think I should be doing something to prepare for the review? It came up at our last Intelligence Steering Committee meeting, but none of the other ambassadors had any ideas. There's really not anything you can do to prepare at this point. Are you implying that we could have done something if we started earlier? Would you have grafted on two more arms to please the Dalniks, or sprouted a tentacle to curry favor with the Drazens? I guess not. Kelly began to push her chair back from the display desk, but changed her mind mid-action and returned to her original position. Am I forgetting anything else? Didn't Donna ask me to do something before leaving? Maybe I should look over my calendar for the next few cycles. Are you that afraid to go home and face Dorothy? Libby asked, her synthesized voice taking on a concerned tone. I know I'm being a bad mother, but I just can't take it anymore. She's been willing herself to be miserable ever since David eloped with Hannah. It's not like he didn't ask Dorothy to marry him at least 3 times. It did seem to me that she was pushing the two of them together, Libby mused. If Dorothy had been a client of my dating service, I would have stopped sending her serious prospects like David until she showed a willingness to commit. That's exactly what I mean. It's been 3 months already, and if she loses any more weight, she's going to be able to model her own clothes. David was a great guy, and I would have been happy to have him as a son-in-law, but whoever heard of finding a future husband in the lost and found? The Strix librarian remained silent. Libby, was the whole David thing one of your setups? Brenda just entered the embassy, Libby announced. No need to get up. I'll override the lock for you. The door to Kelly's office slid open, and 4 puppies, each of which was the size of a mature Great Dane, tried to enter at the same time, creating a jam. Then they burst through all at once, sprawling on the floor and rolling joyfully over one another. The younger Haddad sister followed them into the room. Is it that time already? Kelly asked, surveying the rambunctious puppies with a combination of amusement and dismay. I wish we had room to keep them all, but the truth is we barely have space for Pava, Brenda said, referring to the female kale hound named after the emperor's wife. We would have needed to farm them out cycles ago if Jeeves hadn't temporarily rented the apartment next to ours and put in a dog door to double our space. That was pretty nice of him. He said it was in the benefits section of my partnership agreement for SBJ Fashions, and I didn't ask to read it. My sister's family has been adopted by the female, and one of the males took a fancy to Blythe's twins. She and Clive agreed to accept him on a trial basis, provided we give them a return option. Well, I suppose Beowulf will keep the last two in line until we find somebody they can respect. How did Pava react? She chased them all out of the apartment 5 minutes ago. That's how I knew it was time. The Kale have invested millions of years in breeding these hounds for military service, so they know their duty. Watch this. Brenda clapped once, and the four puppies immediately stopped their frolicking and formed a row, sitting tall on their haunches. Who's going to Shaina? Brenda asked. Fall out and wait for me in the other room. One of the puppies backed out of the row, gave each of her brothers a sniff to impress their sense on her memory, and then trotted out of Kelly's office without looking back. Which one of you picked Blythe's kids? The puppy on the end let its tongue loll out of its mouth, winked at the other two, and then followed his sister. We speak English to them all the time, so you shouldn't have any more trouble communicating than you do with Beowulf, Brenda explained. Which means they'll understand when they want to, the ambassador observed dryly. Okay, I guess the two of you are coming home with me. Kelly eyed the puppies with trepidation, and they both gave her such innocent looks that she just knew they were going to be trouble. The house will feel pretty empty with only Pava left, Brenda remarked wistfully. The two women paused in the outer office, the puppies crowding around them. You still have Walter and the baby, Kelly reminded her. Hey, can I interest you in taking Dorothy off our hands? We'll pay room and board. I'd rather have all of the puppies back, even without the extra apartment space. Dorothy's driving us nuts at work on the odd days she actually bothers to come in. Last week, I asked her what color she wanted for the new prototypes, and she just answered, "What difference does it make? They're just shoes." She said, "What?" I don't believe you. Shoes are her life. Affy and Flazant have both come to me separately to ask if there's anything they can do to help, but even though they're Dorothy's best friends, they have trouble understanding what happened. Affy doesn't get why Dorothy is upset because David was just a... I can't remember her exact term, but it was a Virgilian word that implied a practice boyfriend about whom one feels possessive. That seems like a pretty accurate description. And Flazant keeps forgetting that Dorothy and David didn't have a negotiated companionship agreement, so she's always offering to go over the contract to check for violations. I'll talk to Dorothy again, Kelly replied with a sigh. Maybe the puppies will cheer her up. Brenda repressed a shudder on hearing Kelly's last three words. Ugh. Did you know that Jeeves has been trying to cheer her up at work with his insane concept of humor? Trust me, you don't want examples. The female Kale hound whined and scratched at the floor, evidently in a hurry to move on to her new home. Both women were glad of an excuse to drop the conversation at that point, and they followed the puppies out of the embassy. The ambassador headed for the lift tube with the two she was bringing home, and Brenda strolled off in the opposite direction to drop off a puppy for the twins. When Kelly exited the lift tube in the corridor outside of Max Bones, the two puppies immediately picked up Beowulf's scent and tore off in search of their father. The ambassador followed at a funereal pace, which seemed fitting, given Dorothy's ongoing mourning over the loss of her practice boyfriend.
Can we keep them?
Fenna asked excitedly. Kelly halted her slow march back to the scrapped ice harvester that served as the extended family home, happy for a reason to delay entering. Aisha's six-year-old daughter looked like a doll next to the giant puppies, which were being careful not to knock her down in their frolicking.
If we can't keep them both, can I have one and give the other one to Mikey?
Mikey's mother already took one from the litter, Kelly said, avoiding the rest of the question. Is your mom home?
She's in the kitchen hiding from Auntie Dorothy,
the little girl replied.
Do you think David would come back if we offered him a puppy?
Kelly sighed and pulled up a patio chair to sit so she could talk to Fenna without towering over her. I don't think Dorothy really wants David back. She just didn't want him to leave.
I don't understand,
Fenna said, frowning slightly. Neither does Dorothy. That's the problem.
Then you explain to Daddy so he can explain to us,
the little girl suggested.
Daddy can explain anything to anybody. He even draws pictures.
Kelly smiled and gave a noncommittal nod. Dorothy had always looked up to her adopted older brother as well. It was true that Paul had an engineer's understanding of how things worked, but a young woman's heart wasn't as easily managed as interstellar travel.
"Hello, Fenna, Ambassador," a friendly voice intoned in English.
"Uncle Dring," Fenna exclaimed.
She ran to hug the maker who rented a space in Max Bones for his gravity surfer, which, like the shapeshifter himself, could be reconfigured in infinite forms.
"Are you staying for dinner? Mommy has been in the kitchen cooking for hours."
"Hiding from Dorothy," Kelly muttered under her breath, which drew a sad look from the maker. "You don't know any memory wipe tricks, do you, Dring?"
"Had I not been bound to silence, I could have provided proof enough of a broken heart, even for you."
"Wait, don't tell me," Kelly said, recognizing Jane Austen's language but unable to place the line. It had been a while since she had played the quotation game with Dring, who was an avid reader of human literature. "Pride and Prejudice?" she hazarded a guess.
"Sense and Sensibility," he chided her.
Kelly closed her eyes for a moment and racked her brain for a quote relevant to Dorothy's state of mind. Finally, she blurted, "But what was a girl to Dombey and Son?" Dring shook his head sympathetically.
"You really are out of practice, Ambassador. Dickens, obviously."
"And the book?" Kelly demanded.
"But you already told me the book."
"I did? Oh, it's Dombey and Son, isn't it?"
"Good one, Mom,"
Dorothy said, slouching up to the group in a shapeless garment that might have been a Verloc nightgown.
"I hope you stay for dinner, Dring. Aisha makes way too much when it's her turn to cook."
"Hello, Dorothy. You haven't stopped by my garden lately. Is work keeping you that busy?"
"Work?" The fashion designer looked puzzled for a moment, as if she were trying to recall something. "What day is today?"
"Friday,"
Fenna piped up. "Friday evening," Kelly appended. "If you're just getting up, you missed work again. I had to talk with Brenda just now, and everybody is worried about you at the office."
"I was tired," Dorothy said defensively. "I've been working so much lately that I needed time off to rest."
"That's not what I heard," Kelly replied, tapping her foot and waiting for a response. The mother and daughter glared at each other in a standoff, which the maker finally broke by changing the subject.
"Speaking of fathers and sons, I saw Joe, Paul, and Samuel head out on the Nova earlier."
"They must have gone to look at Paul's surprise anniversary present," Dorothy said.
"Paul bought Aisha something for their anniversary and he took Joe and Samuel to see it?" Kelly asked.
"No,"
her daughter corrected her in a bored tone. "Aisha bought Paul a bunch of abandoned space junk when Griff auctioned it off for unpaid long-term parking bills. I guess Jeeves put her up to it."
"Here comes Daddy now,"
Fenna cried, pointing towards the ceiling over the small ship parking area of Max Bones. The Nova was just penetrating the atmosphere retention field that kept all of the air from rushing out into the Union Station's vast core when the bay doors were open. The tug sat down silently, thanks to a Dalnik docking system, rebuilt by Joe and Paul with help from Jeeves, which could handle small ships over short distances with manipulator fields. The Nova lowered her cargo hatch, which doubled as a ramp, and Beowulf and Samuel charged out.
"Aisha bought Paul a fleet," the teenager yelled when he was still 20 paces away. "There are hundreds of ships in the lot. It must have cost a fortune."
"Libby," Kelly subvoked, "is that right?"
"I would say she got a bargain," the Strix librarian replied privately over Kelly's implant.
"Working for the Granuthians has turned her into a tough negotiator. She also brought Jeeves to the auction with her, leading the other bidders to assume she had Strix backing."
"What are she and Paul going to do with hundreds of alien spacecraft?" "They haven't consulted me about their plans, but I suspect Paul and your husband will try to cannibalize enough parts to repair a number of ships in order to sell them. When owners stop keeping up with their parking fees, it's usually because they've determined the asset isn't worth the outlay."
The two men made their way to the ice harvester, stopping occasionally to retrieve Beowulf's favorite chew toy from whichever puppy ran up and dropped it in front of them, and then throwing it back towards the training area. Beowulf ignored the provocation and strode alongside Joe with the air of a dog that had more important fish to fry.
Samuel ran inside to report to Aisha, Fenna right behind him, and Dorothy allowed Dring to escort her up the ramp, though the maker didn't seem to be having any success at engaging the girl in conversation.
"You should see it, Kel," Joe enthused. "Aisha's finally found something to do with all that money she's been raking in."
His foster son stood by quietly, looking a little dazed by his good fortune.
"Go on, Paul. Get in there and thank her." "It's not our anniversary for another 3 weeks," the younger man mumbled. "I haven't even gotten her anything yet."
"Just seeing your face will be all the present she needs," Kelly said with a laugh, pushing him towards the ramp. "What about you, Joe? Are you going to add a second retirement job?"
"I put some thought into that on the return trip, and I've decided that it's the right time for me to step back from the training camp. I'm getting too old to teach hand-to-hand combat, and all that hardware that Aisha bought, it's like a dream come true."
"I thought you had your fill of the scrap business."
"This is different. When I took over Max Bones, most of the junk was really junk. I mean, it had already been picked over and crushed for recycling, and just finding a usable part was a big deal. I suppose most of the ships in the auction lot are in rough shape, but they all have intact hulls and complete systems, even if they haven't been maintained. You know that at some stage, alien space technology stops advancing quickly because it becomes inefficient to constantly replace equipment that does the job just fine. We can still get parts for most of those ships, or strip them and sell the parts. Comparing Aisha's present to the old Max Bones inventory is like comparing a gold mine to a pile of tailings."
"If you say so," Kelly said agreeably, linking arms with her husband and strolling towards the ice harvester ramp. "As long as you're happy, I'm happy. Who do you think Thomas will bring in to replace you?"
"Probably the agent he had helping when we were on Earth. He said that she had a way with the trainees."
"The one with the sword?"
"Judith. Samuel will be happy to have somebody to practice with instead of the fencing bot."
Kelly scowled, but didn't say anything.
2.
"That green overlay must mean that they're charging their front projectors to fire. Does this ship have any defensive shields?"
"I can't figure out how to turn them on,"
the young man replied, desperately gesturing his way through the options presented by the holographic controller.
"I hoped it would have a Strix controller, but this ship is so old it should be in a Verloc museum. I think these are blueprints and operational procedures, but without being able to read the instructions..."
"They've fired," the older woman said, and simultaneously the lights on the Verloc trader dimmed to the point that the three humans could barely see each other.
"You blocked it, Kevin." "I didn't do anything," the young man protested as power returned to the cabin lighting. "That must have been an automatic defense system. If I understand the yellow indicator up there, deflecting that attack took about a quarter of our power reserves."
"Can we outrun them?" asked the boy, who looked to be around 14.
"I don't think so, Nigel," Kevin said. "The Verloc's built for safety and economy. I don't think they ever cared much about speed."
"We won't be very safe if the pirates catch us again," the woman pointed out unnecessarily. "Especially after we blew up the stasis field generator and stole this ship out of their trophy yard."
"I'm sorry I got you and Nigel into this, Molly," Kevin said, looking away from the control hologram for a moment. "It was a stupid plan."
"It was a good plan," the boy insisted, keeping his eyes on the main view screen. "If the other hostages had taken ships and fled, the pirates couldn't have pursued us all."
"It's not the fault of the aliens," Molly said. "We couldn't risk telling them the plan in advance since they might have spilled the beans to our captors. Most of them are waiting to be ransomed by their families or employers."
"Two more ships are coming for us," Nigel reported, pointing at dots on the screen.
"How do I control the view?"
"It's all gesture-based," Kevin explained. "Just move your hands in front of the screen and try to think like a Verloc. They're very deliberate, so move slowly." The boy began to motion with his arms, like an orchestra conductor submerged in a viscous liquid, and the view on the screen cycled through several variations. Eventually, a number of icons appeared along the bottom of the display. Nigel reached for one that looked like a ball with a tiny representation of the Verloc ship in the middle, closed his fist as if he were grabbing it, and pulled back his arm. A spherical hologram showing the space all around them sprang to life in front of the main view screen.
"That has to be us in the middle. And those three dots following us are pirates. But what are all of these other dots?"
Nigel asked.
"I'm afraid they're more pirates,"
his mother replied. She started to reach towards the hologram, but a grimace of pain distorted her features and she barely avoided crying out.
Try to zoom in. Do you see them, Kevin?
The young man looked up from the holographic controller again, and his expression grew even grimmer.
I'll aim for the largest gap, between those four, he said, pointing at the encircling ships. It's probably a trap, but it beats flying straight at one of them when I can't find any controls for offensive weaponry. They must have called in allied pirate crews to surround us so quickly.
The cabin lights and the hologram dimmed again, and this time the ship lurched slightly.
We're down to 50%, Kevin reported. I'm sorry, but I don't see a way out. I don't want to be a slave, the boy said. I'd rather die fighting.
Oh, Nigel. Molly regarded her son with a mixture of sadness and pride, but she knew there was nothing they could hope to accomplish against pirates in armored spacesuits.
Hold on. This could be something, Kevin said.
The controller hologram was displaying an interior view of the cabin in miniature. Situated between the acceleration chair occupied by the young man and the one shared by Nigel and his mother was a bright blue column that was pulsing with energy.
Is it a hologram of a hologram?
He asked himself out loud, making an upward gesture with his left hand. As near as he could tell, Verloc's read from bottom to top, so the previous image would be found below the current one.
Is that a handle in the deck?
Nigel asked, leaning over to look down at the space between the two overlarge acceleration couches which were intended for much bulkier aliens. Kevin leaned over from his own side, the four-point restraint that couldn't pull tight to human size allowing him plenty of latitude for moving around.
Yeah. The way they show it and what I think is the instructions, I have to rotate the handle a quarter turn, and then the thing will rise out of the deck.
He put his words into action, wrapping his fingers around the recessed bar at the center of what looked like a circular plate and twisting. A glowing blue column rose up into the cabin, pulsing with light and sound. Kevin could feel the song of power throbbing in his bones, but there were no controls visible on the cylinder, and it didn't respond to hand motions.
What is it? Molly asked. It might be the thing referenced by all of the schematics I flipped through, but whether that makes it the power source or some kind of fail-safe device, I don't know.
The cabin lights went out for a third time, indicating that the pirates had fired their weapons again, but the blue column seemed to be undisturbed by the energy drain.
Maybe it's a weapon, Nigel ventured hopefully. It looks really powerful. A weapon inside the cabin.
Kevin turned back to the controller and slid the hologram up and down, looking for a graphical explanation of how to activate the device and what it did.
None of this makes any sense. I think that those red squares are Verloc warning signs, but why would they show instructions at all if the thing is dangerous? Maybe it's a self-destruct device, the boy said, sounding almost hopeful. I saw a Vergalian immersive once where a crippled ship's crew took their attackers with them by exploding like a star.
You're too young to give up, Molly told him, struggling to keep a pleading tone out of her voice. Even if we didn't get away from the pirates this time, there will be other chances for you.
I don't think it's a self-destruct, Kevin said. The holograms remind me of the lifeboat instructions for the trader I was piloting when the pirates caught me. I think it's some kind of escape mechanism.
Could it be a one-shot jump drive? Molly asked. I saw a Granuthian documentary about faster-than-light technology a few years ago, and I remember that some of the advanced species developed unique ways to fold space before they joined the Strix Tunnel Network.
Maybe it does something like that. I don't know. But I can't see how to choose a destination, much less activate it, Kevin replied.
Who cares about where it takes us? The boy almost shouted, pointing at the rapidly closing ships depicted in the spherical hologram.
One more shot and our defensive screens will be down. They'll match our speed, catch us with magnetic grapples, and board in armored spacesuits. It's how they seized our survey ship.
Kevin scrolled rapidly through holograms, looking for anything that might indicate how the cylindrical device was activated. Finally, he spotted a red box around a blue circle on the arm of an acceleration chair. He looked down and saw that a small cavity had opened just beyond where his hand would rest had he been a little larger and sitting normally. He squirmed out of half of the safety restraints and leaned forward.
There are three buttons in the arm of my chair that might activate the device, he reported. I didn't notice them before. The access panel must have opened when the thing rose out of the deck.
There's one on our chair, too, Nigel confirmed. I can barely reach all three buttons at the same time. The Verlocs must have big hands.
Did you just press them? His mother asked sharply.
Nothing happened, the boy replied in disappointment. The lights and the holograms winked out again, and this time they didn't come back on. If not for the pulsing column of blue light, the fugitives would have been sitting in the dark.
That's it, then. We're defenseless, Kevin said. They can fire again or come and gather us in at their leisure.
Try your buttons, the boy urged him. I don't care if it is a self-destruct. The young man glanced over at the boy's mother, who gave him a sad nod, and he depressed all three of the buttons, using his pinky and ring finger together on the third one. Nothing happened.
I hate this, Nigel exclaimed.
We can't fight, we can't run, we can't even see what's going on.
Maybe you need to push the buttons together, Molly said slowly.
I did, Kevin replied.
Me too, her son added.
I mean the two of you at the same time, the woman said.
It makes sense, doesn't it? It's a two Verloc ship, and they'd want to agree before bailing out or blowing themselves up.
There was a clank on the hull as a magnetic grappler made contact. Kevin looked over at his companions, who were lit by the eerie blue glow, and said,
On three. All right?
Do it, the boy replied stiffly.
One, two, three.
Kevin and Nigel each pushed in their three buttons, and with a flash of blue light and a mind-bending lurch, the universe turned itself inside out. For a very long time, it seemed to Kevin that his mind was floating alone in the cosmos. He tried to speak and couldn't even hear himself in his own head. He wondered if this was death, but then the main display screen flickered back on and a voice began speaking.
You have accessed the Verloc Trading Guild's Emergency Recovery Network, better known as VITGERN. The three humans burst out in cheers, missing a sentence of the message because they couldn't make anything of the alien script that marched up the main screen in synchronization with the audio message translated by their implants.
Leading to the closure of this network during the reign of Shrylenth the 2007th.
The message stopped scrolling and the audio fell silent.
What was that? Molly cried.
Something about the rescue network being closed, her son replied.
Can you replay it? He asked Kevin.
I didn't play it to start with. It just came on.
The main screen flashed again, and a different recorded message began playing back while Verloc's script scrolled up the screen in sync.
Under the abandoned in-place clause of the Tunnel Network Agreement for Obsolete Hyperspace Infrastructure, VITGERN is now under the management of a Strix Working Group for Transitional Technologies. If you continue beyond this point, you may be charged for towing and associated rescue fees, and there will be a required payment equal to 100% of the assessed value of your ship which goes to fund this working group. If you do not wish to be rerouted to the Strix Tunnel Network Connector, simply repeat the initiation sequence for your VITGERN device, and you will be returned to your point of departure.
What did all that mean? Nigel asked.
If we don't want to pay, we can go back to being captured by pirates, Kevin said with a laugh. The Strix can have 200% of this ship as far as I'm concerned.
Mom, are you all right?
Kevin looked over and saw that Molly had slumped onto her son's shoulder, her arm held at an unnatural angle.
Don't shake her, he told Nigel. She got banged up worse than either of us when we made our escape from that Hulk. Her arm looks broken, so it's better that she sleeps if she can. You've got a tough woman for a mother.
I know that, Nigel replied, fierce pride showing in his eyes. When Dad died, she kept right on doing the alien archaeological survey work he contracted for, even though the universities offered to let her out of it.
Rerouting to the Strix Tunnel Connector, the voice announced.
A hologram appeared displaying a spiral galaxy with a large red dot accompanied by a bit of Verloc script positioned far out on one of the spiral arms. Then a network of white lines crisscrossing the galaxy leapt into existence, much denser in some areas than others.
At 100 or so well-spaced spots, the lines converged to points that looked like solid white balls due to the density of the connections.
"It's the tunnel network,"
Kevin said, unable to keep the awe from his voice.
"I've never seen a representation like this before. The solid white balls must be the station hubs."
"We have to get Mom to a doctor."
Nigel's voice sounded much younger and less certain now that the immediate danger had passed. A blinking white line came to life, connecting the red dot to one of the white balls, and a moment later, Kevin felt the familiar distortion of entering a Strix tunnel. A weird bass rumble began rising and falling in the background, accompanied by the occasional chime.
"Maybe I better take a look at her arm,"
he said, slipping out of the ineffective safety restraints without bothering to undo them.
"We could be in the tunnel for days."
The boy groaned with frustration and studied the hologram, trying to guess what was being depicted.
"Look, we're a quarter of the way there already."
Kevin pivoted about and stared at the hologram. The red dot was moving up the blinking white line at an incredible clip.
"This isn't like any tunnel trip I've ever taken. I hope it doesn't scramble our brains. And I wonder what's causing all the weird sounds."
"Maybe it's Verloc lift tube music,"
Nigel speculated. He stared at the moving red dot in rapt concentration, willing it to take them to their destination faster.
"Why didn't we go to the nearest hub?"
"Don't know," Kevin replied. "At the speed we're moving, I guess it just doesn't make much difference. We're going to be there in just a few."
The hologram of the Milky Way disappeared, replaced by a field of stars and a giant cylindrical structure which dwarfed the arriving and departing ships to insignificance. Kevin and Nigel both found themselves closing their eyes to try to keep the cabin from spinning, which only made it worse. The ship's comm crackled to life. "If you require assistance, do not respond to this hail, and we will initiate retrieval in 53 seconds. Your bill for accessing the abandoned emergency network may be waived if you turn over your ship and the Vitgern device for decommissioning and can demonstrate income below the tunnel network median. Please eject any banned substances into space at this time for collection by bots. Thank you for choosing Union Station." Kevin forced his eyes back open and stared at the hologram of the busy Strix station in disbelief.
"Do we have any banned substances?" Nigel asked.
"We don't have anything other than the clothes on our backs. If there are any drugs hidden on the ship, they can confiscate them."
"Whoa,"
he added, tumbling back onto the acceleration couch as the ship began accelerating towards the station.
"They've grabbed us with something. Hang on, Molly. I bet they have a med bot waiting in the hangar."
3.
"What happened to you?"
Woojin addressed his boss. The director of EarthCent Intelligence shuffled into the meeting like a 90-year-old man in poor health.
"Back," Clive grimaced. "I would have skipped today, but Blythe couldn't make it because she's with Chastity and the midwife waiting on the baby."
"That's right. She was almost exactly 3 weeks ahead of me," Lynx said, glancing at her own maternity countdown watch.
"Did you try to pick her up or something?"
"The puppy,"
Clive replied, carefully lowering himself into a chair. He froze more than once during the process, causing the others to wince in sympathy.
"Okay, I'll bite," Walter said. "Why would you try to pick up a puppy that's almost big enough to rent out for ponyback rides? The last time I lifted any of those short-haired eating machines was to give them baths after they rolled around in... never mind."
"The kids," Clive explained. "Vivian and Jonah got the puppy to lie on a rug and they were trying to pick him up together. I had the sudden urge to show off."
"Establishing dominance,"
Thomas commented.
"I've been told that dogs are uncomfortable in a new home until they figure out who's in charge."
"Speaking of who's in charge, why are we having this meeting?" Lynx asked.
"To discuss the upcoming review of humanity's status on the tunnel network," Clive replied. "Kelly relayed a request from the steering committee to support the ambassadors in preparing for special encounters with their alien peers. The review is taking place on every Strix station where EarthCent has a diplomatic presence."
"How can we prepare for a Strix review?"
Thomas asked.
I'm sure they have well-defined criteria against which to measure humanity's progress, just like the test I took to establish my sentience as an artificial person. We aren't going to change their assessment now because we rush out and help alien grandmothers carry home the groceries.
Clive began to laugh and then froze again as his back went into a fresh spasm.
New rule. No making the intelligence director laugh. You should go see the Farling doctor, Woojin told him. Look what he did for us.
Yeah, us, Lynx groused, patting her distended abdomen and inspecting her watch again. 20 days, 17 hours, and 32 minutes until liftoff.
I've never been much for doctors, Clive said, grimacing again. And in answer to your question, Thomas, what the ambassadors really want is help with the confrontational part of the process, where the alien diplomats might present objections to our becoming full members of the tunnel network.
And why did you want me here? Walter asked.
I assume the Galactic Free Press will be covering the review process, and I was hoping that your sources might be able to shed some light on what we can expect. We haven't really concentrated any resources on trying to figure out why aliens might dislike us, though now that it comes up, I think that was probably an error on our part.
So you expect the Granuthians to complain that humans are cutting into their news business, and the Hortons to complain that we win too many gaming tournaments?
I really don't know, Clive admitted. The ambassadors have tried teasing some answers out of Strix librarians on several stations without success, and Jeeves ignored my invitation to attend this meeting. I sent an information request to our colleagues in Drazen Intelligence asking about their own review, but it happened around 500,000 years ago, and the records don't go back that far.
Does anybody really believe that the Strix will modify their conclusions based on input from the other species?
Thomas inquired skeptically.
I'm the last sentient who is going to criticize how the Strix go about their business, but they aren't exactly running a democracy. Clive wouldn't have pulled his back lifting that puppy if the Strix hadn't sent Brinda to the Kale as a hostage along with you too.
He made a gesture that took in Lynx and Woojin, while they were manipulating the Emperor into preserving his empire.
New rule, Clive groaned. No using back and puppy in the same sentence. And you're probably right about the alien input being for show, but we have to make an effort to help the diplomatic branch when they put in a request. Does anybody have any ideas? Go see the Farling, Woojin repeated. He has a medical shop on the travel concourse. You'll be back to lifting puppies in no time.
Clive turned his head to give the spy agency's strategic planner the evil eye, but he froze midway as a new spasm hit.
Actually, I do have one suggestion, Walter said. I'm sure you all remember that I have a background in political science and that I dabbled a little in electoral politics when I first came to the station. In the last century before the Strix opened Earth and de-emphasized national governments, candidates for high office often staged confrontational debates.
So you see humanity as a candidate for higher status on the tunnel network and the advanced species as debate opponents? Lynx surmised. That's an interesting analogy.
I wasn't making an analogy, Walter replied impatiently. The point is that the candidates prepared themselves for these events by staging practice debates, with advisors playing the roles of their opponents. If EarthCent Intelligence can work up a series of objections that each species is likely to raise, we could distribute a list to the ambassadors, and they could practice rebutting the accusations with their staff.
I like it,
Clive said, relieved that they had come up with something that would bring the meeting closer to an end.
I'll run it by Blythe later. I mean, I'll tell her that's what we've decided.
Maybe we could use some of the alien actors we've hired for the training camp to play the parts of the alien ambassadors for Kelly,
Woojin suggested.
Excellent idea, Walter concurred. I've read that those practice debates worked best when staged in a manner to make them as close to the real experience as possible.
He rose from his chair, touched his toes, and stretched ostentatiously.
Well, unless you need me to lift something, I've got a newspaper to run while my boss is out on maternity leave.
Nobody objected, and Walter absented himself from the meeting room.
Woojin got up to make his wife a cup of decaf tea, and Thomas issued a silent command that caused a schedule for the training camp in Max Bones to appear on the wall-sized conference room display. The tip of one of his pinkies lit up with a laser on low intensity, and he used it to point out the organizational chart of facial images that appeared in the staffing section. "What's this?" Lynx asked.
"Joe has put in for retirement,"
the artificial person replied. "Aisha bought Paul an alien ship graveyard for their anniversary, and Joe is going to join him full-time in the salvage business."
"Does anybody have an idea how much she paid?"
Woojin asked out of curiosity.
"It's public information," Clive said. "I forget the exact figure, but after Blythe got it from Libby, she commented that she knew Aisha was wealthy, but she didn't know she was that wealthy."
"Getting back to the subject at hand, Joe said that eventually he may have to kick us out of the hole to make room,"
Thomas informed them. "Make room? But Max Bones is huge," Lynx objected.
"And Paul now owns hundreds of alien spacecraft, many of which they'll want to bring into Max Bones to save on commuting out to the park in orbit. Some jobs are easier in zero-G, but for the main part, humans work better when they weigh something, not to mention having an atmosphere and other health benefits," Thomas said. "The hold won't fill up tomorrow or next cycle, but keep it in mind."
"Judith is taking his place?"
Woojin asked, looking at the faces on the screen.
"She's getting better with that rapier, but we don't teach fencing to the trainees, and I don't remember her rating in hand-to-hand combat."
"I recently integrated a jiu-jitsu master upgrade from Quick U, and I've been teaching her," Thomas informed them. "She'll do fine as long as she remembers that it's training and not combat. Chance is testing a Virgilian martial arts upgrade from Quick U herself, so she can always cover if Judith or I need help."
"If you can get chance to show up in the morning," Lynx said. "Have the two of you sparred?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.